First of all, welcome to the first Early Researchers Seminar Series hosted by the Cambridge Reproduction SRI. So the Cambridge Reproduction SRI is an interdisciplinary initiative that brings together researchers from across the university who have an interest in any aspect of reproduction. That includes science and technology to cultural studies and the humanities. And then the seminar series is also part of the SRI, which will be held on the second Thursday of each month at 1 p.m. And you can find details about future seminars online as well, and possibly also in the chat. And I'd also like to thank the organizers and speakers of this series. Specifically, that includes Christina Rosaic, who's the coordinator of the initiative overall, as well as the volunteer coordinators of the lecture series, Tara Asgarilale, Grace Campbell, Daphne Lima, Claire Senner, and Ellen Wall. Next, I'm really happy to introduce our two exciting speakers for today. Stephanie Helsberger is a second year PhD candidate at the Center for Gender Studies. Her research focuses on fertility tracking applications and asks how women in Egypt and Austria navigate the commodification of personal data that question conceptions of gender and labor in relation to surveillance capitalism, data ownership, and commodification. Prior to coming to Cambridge, Stephanie studied political science and Arabic studies at the University of Vienna, and she also worked as a Bartlett Fellow at the American University in Cairo. Today, Stephanie will present a talk titled Data Flows, Monetizing Periods on Period Tracking Applications, discussing apps, industry claims, making practices, financial models, and data collection methods. This presentation will address questions of the commodification of menstruation within surveillance capitalism.
All right, cool. I'll start sharing my screen. Lovely, yes, hope that's working. All right, so yeah, thank you for the introduction. And also thank you for that really interesting talk. That was super, I learned a lot. Really excited to be talking today. And Jar already said, I'm a second year PhD at the Center for Gender Studies, and my talk today will focus on data flows, monetizing periods, and specifically data commodification. I also wanted to thank the Cambridge Reproduction SRI for inviting me today to give the talk, and I'm really excited to kick off the Early Researcher Seminar Series. And also thank you to Christina and Daphne for all the help in getting us sorted before the talk today. So a quick outline of what I'll talk about. So I'll focus mainly on the first part, and I'll explain how period trackers and data commodification are connected. I'll talk a bit about the boom in fintech and health applications. And then I'll talk a bit about the claims that these apps are structured around and based on. And then I'll touch upon how they're situated in surveillance capitalism and what that means for how the apps function. And then I'll quickly touch upon some of the popular apps and their business model. And towards the end, I'll talk about my theoretical framing and methodology for my fieldwork, which is hopefully going to start in January. All right, so to give some context of what my overall PhD focuses on, I'm very interested to see how we can conceptualize the user in thinking about surveillance capitalism or the digital economy. If we look at the overall literature, much focus is always placed on what companies do, what business models they have, how they make money, and very, very little effort is spent on thinking about what the role of users is. And it also tells us that the term that we use here is users, which doesn't imply a lot of agency. So I'm really interested to see what people think about the time and effort and work that they put into creating this data that is then collected and enclosed and aggregated and sold by many, many different companies and actors. And to answer this question and to contribute to this literature, I'm looking at period tracking applications to see how women who use the apps think about these things. And just to give you some context on what period trackers are, this is a small screenshot of some of them that are available on the Play Store. So you can see they're all very big. So the apps are basically just different types of app that help women to track, or people who menstruate, to keep track of their cycle. And there's many, many different ones that are designed with a different goal in mind. So some might help women to become pregnant, others might help prevent pregnancy, others are just focused on tracking health indicators or sexual activities, others are focused on tracking hormones. And what's important about all of them is that they're part of this really, this fairly recent boom in like femtech. That's kind of the term that is used. So it's just a lot of different technologies around improving women's health. There's things like smart cups, which I think are like a smart period cup, which is slightly out there. But yeah, so this has been an industry that has really, really, really grown very, very fast in the past 5 to 8 years, with like $1 billion investment until 2018. But it actually took a while for these technology producers to kind of start paying attention to women's particular health needs. Because the larger like self-tracking and like health app industry is a bit older. And if we think about the Fitbits, and Fitbit has been around for a while, but neither Fitbit nor, for example, Apple's health app had any possibility for women to track their cycle, which is quite a glaring omission considering how much effect periods has on overall health and well-being for women. And this leads us also to one important thing that we need to know when we think about these apps, and that's that they're not in any sort of way medical technology, but they're self-tracking technology. So they're very firmly set within this whole larger movement of tracking information about yourself to like improve your life or improve understanding, or like it's kind of like a Fitbit for your period, right? So the apps are also not, there's only one app that is FDA approved or like licensed by state institutions, and most others just kind of pop up on the app store. And also as opposed to other like reproductive technologies, which are usually surrounded by like discussion in society, like IVF, it's like, do we want this? What are the harms? This type of technology is not like intense debate over whether this is a good thing or a bad thing. I think only in the last few years, there's been a bit more attention on these apps. And yeah, now I want to start looking at the claims or these like the notions that these apps are founded upon. And they're really related to the headline of The Observer that we can see here, where it says big data can unlock the secrets of our bodies. And so these apps are founded on this logic that the more data you give them, the better they will be able to help you discover secrets about your body. And they position themselves in a way that they are the only ones who can provide this type of information. And this is insights into your body that you wouldn't be able to find anywhere else, or if you would do tracking by yourself. So the apps are really like positioning themselves in a very particular way. And they're also trying to, or some more than others, are trying to place themselves so that they can like fill gaps that women have about knowledge about their overall health or reproductive health and menstruation in particular. So the question is, what do these apps track? This is a very lovely infographic that kind of shows the extent of information that the apps ask women to input. So it's also important to note that these are self-tracking applications, right? So they depend on women inputting this information into the apps themselves and regularly. They also track some information on the side, but that depends on the app. And as you can see, if you look on the left side of this image, there's a very, very vast variety of different types of information that these apps are after. It's everything from when menstruation has occurred, what the blood flow was like, how much volume there was. It's everything about sex life, how many times, what kind of positions, what kind of sex, has there been an orgasm? So they're very, very detailed. Also in terms of questions about the body and like how different symptoms of like bodily functions throughout the month change. Anything from weight, cramps, pelvic pain, nausea, acne, constipation, sleep, workout. They're also interested in emotional indicators, such as how active have you been? Are you confused? Are you sad? Are you happy? Personal data, which is like bank information, phone numbers. So there's a really, really vast, vast amount of information that these apps want access to. And then, so the question is, what do women receive in return for all this information that they share? And it's kind of just 2.5 points of information. And the first is the timing of their period or their upcoming period and the timing of their window of fertility, like ovulation, and sometimes also PMS, but that depends on the app. So we can see that there's a really big like disparity between the types of all the information that women share and the things that they get back in return. Some apps also do a semi-good job at visualizing the information that you give them, but really what you receive back in terms of, you know, the secrets that these apps reveal about your bodies, it's very, very limited. And most of the apps also, there's been a study that was done a few years ago on existing apps and their accuracy in predicting periods and in predicting fertility windows. And the apps did a very, very bad job at this, because most of them, they don't work with like a fertility tracking method. So they mostly just look at the average number of days that your cycle is and then project that into the future, which doesn't really work if you have a slightly irregular cycle or if, you know, something disrupts your hormonal balance or something like that. And this really tells us a lot about the context in which those apps function and also what their goals are. And this context would be surveillance capitalism. And surveillance capitalism is a term that was coined by Shoshana Zuboff to kind of explain this overall development whereby all those companies online, like Google, Facebook, and Amazon, collect copious amounts of data and then sell data as a commodity or sell insights derived from an analysis of that data for targeted advertising or for other purposes. And data here is both simultaneously a source of value and of knowledge. And this connection is really key because the value of the data is also derived from the insights that you can derive from it. And period trackers and the data that comes from them really encapsulates this interconnection. And for me, they're a very interesting vantage point into this data economy. And another reason why I'm looking at period trackers is because the information, whether or not a woman is pregnant or where in the cycle a woman is very, very valuable for advertisers. And I'll explain that in the next few slides. So if you look to the right, this is a screenshot from a report from Privacy International, where they looked at how the different apps share data with different advertisers and Google and Facebook. And you can see that in the US, advertisers value a pregnant woman's data at $1.50 as opposed to an average person's data that's only worth 10 cents. So that information of whether someone's pregnant or not is really, really valuable. And it's because advertisers for quite a long time have been trying to find out whether women are pregnant, because along their logic, women who are pregnant change their shopping habits. So if you can kind of get in to this like changing like ways of shopping and what you need, that's a really, really valuable thing to do, because you will probably, like, it's worth, like, these habits will maintain or will be maintained for a while. It's also telling that they don't consider fathers a worthy target, so they're only geared towards women. And an example that really kind of showcases the extent of how companies deal with this and how important this information is the so-called target baby. That's a term that came up in like popular discourse. And the story behind it is a father, like that it happened like 10 years ago, a father who he went to Target complaining about the fact that his daughter, who was at the time 18, and who wasn't married, wasn't trying to be pregnant or anything, had received a brochure from Target, including just all things related to pregnancy, motherhood, baby stuff. Like, it was just a whole brochure full of these things. And he went to Target, to like the local shop, and complained about it, saying that they were trying to force his daughter to like, or not force, or encourage her to become pregnant. And he thought that was very sexist. And he was like, that's, what are you doing? And so Target apologized and said they were going to look into it. But then a few days later, the father returned to the shop and kind of apologized himself, because it had turned out that his daughter had had unprotected sex and had looked up information around pregnancy, signs of pregnancy, pregnancy tests. And so what Target had done was, because for Target, it's already been really important to find out whether somebody is getting pregnant or not, they by Google search the information, and then based on this information, they will decide who receives what kind of, you know, advertising brochures. And this takes us to this little screenshot where Target discovered that it was creeping people out that the company did this. So what they do now is they kind of hide the pregnancy targeted ads within a larger brochure of just other random things, so that you don't know what they're doing. But yeah, this kind of illustrates the extent to which targeting pregnant women has been a consistent thing in advertising. There's another like case study that a woman who's researching these things did, who she tried to hide her own pregnancy from online advertisers, which meant that she tried to not buy anything online, not use her credit card to buy anything about pregnancy, not to research anything about it, not to send any emails, not to send any messages to anybody about her pregnancy. And it was very difficult. And at some point she would get notifications from her bank saying that that her activity is very suspicious, because she would withdraw too much money. And that also kind of shows us that it's very, very difficult to opt out of this. Yeah, that's a quite worrying development. And so period trackers have access to this, exactly this type of information, right? Whether somebody is pregnant or not, period trackers will know. And there's another side to this targeted advertisement, and that's cycle-based advertising. And I think that's something that only became a bit more popular in the last few years. But the logic here is that during the first half of the cycle, women might be more interested in things like makeup or sexy underwear, and versus the last second part of the cycle, they're more interested in like home building, nesting related, nesting related products. So advertisers also will try to send ads based on where they know a woman is in their cycle. And this is exactly the type of information that these apps would share with advertisers. So I'll move on to talking a bit about different period tracking apps and the different ways that they make money and what happens to the data. And there's like three larger examples. So some of these apps make money through funding, like seed funding, as is usual for like any type of startup. Others make money only by selling the data that they gather. And then others sell a mixture of data, or they might have a subscription model if they're registered as an actual contraceptive, or they might be making money by selling a product like a thermometer to measure your temperature. And like we already said, what happens to the data? Sometimes it's shared with research institutions, depending on how the app positions itself. Sometimes it's just sold directly. Sometimes inserts derived from it are sold for marketing or advertising purposes. Or at other times, it's added to already existing aggregated data profiles. And I'll talk about three apps very briefly. The first one is Clue, and Clue is an interesting example because in this brief screenshot that I shared at the beginning, you could see that all apps are very, very pink. and very flowery and slightly infantilizing. And Clue is one of the exceptions that tries to portray itself more of like as a feminist period app. It also, let's say, pretends to care a lot more about data privacy. So in the early days of Clue, it was possible to keep all your data on your phone. But now that's not possible anymore, and you have to actually make a profile and the data gets shared with the app. And they also have very extensive cooperations with research institutes. So they really try to portray themselves as like an app that revolutionizes women's health and that tries to like solve a problem more than an app that tries to, or like a business that actually tries to make money in this like data economy. But if we go back to the report from Privacy International that looked at how different apps share information, or if they do, Clue would also share information with Google and Facebook. And opposed to many of the other apps, they kind of changed their policies, but initially when nobody was looking, they were still also participating in this selling of data. Another example is Glow. And Glow is one of the founders of Glow is also affiliated with one of the board members of Bitcoin. So it really shows also where the interest for these apps also is coming from. And Glow is a very interesting example as well, because their business model is strictly focused on selling data. And what they do is also try to kind of catch women in all different stages of life. So they have 5 or 4 different apps for different purposes. So one is for very young women who just started to get the period. One is for women who are more interested to like track their sex lives. One is for women who try to become pregnant. One is to track your pregnancy. And then there's one to track your baby's growth after it was born. And very briefly, the last one is Natural Cycles. It's the only FDA registered and cleared birth control app. And it's also registered in the EU as a birth control contraceptive, but there has been like quite a big backlash against them because the way that they represented themselves in marketing portrayed the app to be a lot more reliable, and quite a large number of women who've used the app also reported unwanted pregnancies. And then just very briefly to talk about my theoretical framing again. So yeah, I'm in my field work going to talk to different women in Egypt and in Austria, and I'm going to ask them how they think about the data, how they think about the time that they spend on these apps. And like my hopes or ideas are to like kind of try and see if data production can be framed as labor, and to see what the benefits of thinking about it as that can be, so that users can move away from being something or someone who can just decide to use or not use something to be a bit more active and have a bigger say in how these technologies work. And I'll just leave this image here. And thank you so much for listening. And I'm really looking forward to questions. Mm-hmm.